Okay, so knowing that this is not equal, what does that teach us about the square root of x plus the square root of y?
They're two different things and you can't just combine them because they both have a square root symbol in there.
Okay, so we learned that when we're working with square roots, you can't just add square roots together, like square root of x plus y inside, right? We just learned that this is not the case. Okay, now I am pretty confident that even though so many of us said false, everybody who responded said false, and Sean provided us with such a great explanation of why they're not equal, there may come times when we're simplifying an expression of some kind, and maybe by accident or forgetfulness or just going too quickly, we do take the square root of x plus the square root of y and get the square root of x plus y. Because we're just probably not thinking at that moment. But I'm going to remind you of an example like this, okay? Rather than just say, no, you can't do that, and then walk away, okay? That's not very helpful. I'll give you an example of why that couldn't be the case. Why the square root of x plus the square root of y is not the square root of adding x and y. Okay, well, less investigation would be good for that tonight than I thought we need to do. So let's move on. Let's take the square root of 25 times the square root of 9, okay? Is that, question mark, equal to the square root of 225?
Yeah.
If I were to multiply these together, 25 times 9, is that equal to the square root of 225? So that's the question. Can we simplify that somehow? Square root of x times the square root of y? We don't have to use our cards this time. What do you think? I'll multiply square root of x times the square root of y and just write it as something different. Remember the previous examples of square root of x, well, square root plus square root, right? We concluded that square root x plus square root y is not square root of x plus y. You can't just say square root of, add the things together. Okay? But square root of 25 times the square root of 9, the square root of 25 times 9. Square root of 36 times square root of 49 is the square root of 36 times 49. So the square root of x times the square root of y, Josie?
The square root of xy.
Xy. X being written next to y meaning x times y. What do you guys think about that? Does that fit the last couple examples we just did? We use the square root of 25 and the square root of 9, right? Multiply those together. You know, I wrote 225, but how do we get 225?
By 25 times 9.
25 times 9. That's x and that's y. That's x times y, right? Then we use the square root of 36 times the square root of 49. Multiply them together. We got 1,764. But where did 1,764 come from?
36
times 49. If that were x and that were y, that would be xy. Right?
Right.
So you guys think square root of x times square root of y? Square root of x times y?
Yeah.
Right, the square root of x times the square root of one thing times the square root of another thing. We've just shown it two times. I mean, two times is not a proof, but certainly it's two examples that seemed fairly randomly chosen. We can multiply them together and inside the square root. And either way we got the same thing, which was not the case when we were adding them together. You can't add them together inside the square root. It's not a generally applicable rule. Try something and see how it goes. The thing about mathematics is that you can't just say, well, it worked twice, so it always works for everything. It might seem like it works, but there's many times throughout math history where you thought something worked all the time for every situation, and then it turned out the 100th example, the 100th situation didn't work. So 99 examples worked, and then the 100th didn't. Okay, that's where a proof comes in. You gotta prove that it's true, or that it's not true, for all numbers. Well, we'll just leave it. I was gonna write out this proof, but we'll save that for another day or even another year. But generally, I can confirm that is a rule. So if you see two square roots multiplied together, you can write them together under the same square root. Vice versa, if we see a square root of a big, long thing, we can break it up into the square roots of things times each other. Okay, so let me show you what I mean. Square root of 8 times the square root of 2. Okay. Does 8 have a square root?
Yes.
Not sure.
Does it have a nice square root? Square root of 8 is not a whole number. Is square root of 2 a whole number? Square root of 1 is 1. Square root of 4 is 2. But square root of 2 is some decimal.
Yeah.
1.414 something. But according to this rule, I could write this as the square root of
8 times 2.
8 times 2 is 16. Does 16 have a nice square root?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. It does. It's just the square root of 4. No, it's not the square root of 4. It is 4. Because 4 times 4 is 16. So we can put square roots together, make a square root that actually works out nicely, and we get a nice simplified answer. Likewise, if I had, say, the square root of 50, okay, does 50 have a nice square root? The square root of 50 is 4 or 7?
No.
49 has a nice square root. Right? The square root of 49 is 7.
Yeah.
It's just one away from that. The square root of 50 is, well, 7.1 or some pretty small decimal after 7. But I could write this as the square root of times the square root of, where one of these does have a nice square root.
49
plus 1. But can we add? We have that rule already. 25. You cannot do that. What's that?
25
has a nice square root. 2 doesn't. But at least one of these can be simplified. What's the square root of 25?
5.
So 5 times the square root of 2, or what we call 5 root 2. If I say 5 root 2, it means 5 times the square root of 2. The square root of 50 becomes 5 times the square root of 2. There's this area of like grade school and high school and middle school mathematics called simplifying, and this would be what you would call the simplified version of this. Okay, and for all of my math career, I've never really been fully convinced of why that is simpler than this. What do you guys think? Do you have any argument why this is simpler than that?
Well, because that doesn't have a nice square root. And
this one doesn't?
The 50.
This one doesn't?
No.
But this one has at least part of it is a nice square root, a nice whole number?
Yeah.
Okay. So at least part of it gets to be square rooted, and that's kind of nice. Also, you know, the numbers are smaller, so I guess that's kind of nice. If you know about how big the square root of 2 is, and you know, well, you know how big 5 is, right? Then you can kind of guess about how big this is. Although, it's easier for me to see that the square root of this is a little bit bigger than 7 than to see that 5 times the square root of 2 is a little bit bigger than 7. But, anyway, when I say simplify, it means to take it from like one big square root like this that does not have a nice answer to, well, something that at least does have part of a nice answer. Okay. So all that is to say, why this is called simpler and this is not called simpler, I can't really tell you. I don't know why this got the name simpler and this is called simplified and this is not. But just to let you know, that's what we call simplified. Let's try it once more. You try. If I give you the square root of 48, see if you can, as I did there, simplify that square root. So, let me scroll up a little bit, the square root of 48, you would simplify that very similarly to the way I simplified the square root of 50. Gritty.
I did 3 equals square root of 12 times square root of 4.
Okay.
And I simplified 4, so it's easy.
So, 2.
But, and then I just did times 12. So square root of 12.
Times square root of 12. Okay? Certainly true. Is there, can we go bigger? Like, can we get a bigger number outside the square root? So break it down like each step. You got the square root of something times the square root of something.
I got the square root of 16 times the square root.
So 4 is a number that has a square root, right? So we are closer to having simplified. But 16 is also a factor of 48. It's a bigger number. Also has a nice square root. The square root of 16 is 4, right? So we get 4 root 3. So even simpler. Let's take Grady's answer and turn it into Charlie's answer. How about square root of 12? Can we break that down? Square root of 12, just the way that we broke down square root of 48. Square root of something times square root of something. So we got 2 times the square root of 4 times the square root of 3.
Oh.
Right? And the square root of 4?
2.
It's 2, and 2 times 2. It's 4 square root of 3, same as what Charlie got. Charlie just got it in 2 steps, or this took 4 steps. 2 times 3 steps. Of course, both correct. Both have now been as simplified as possible because I cannot work on the square root of 3. There is no 3's prime. It's not going to break down anymore. Okay, how about the square root of 12 times the square root of 3? How do we simplify square root of 12 times square root of 3? Okay.
12 times 2 is 36.
So you just multiply 12 times 3.
And then the square root of 36 is 6.
All right. So neither 12 nor 3 have square roots. We can multiply them together, and, well, lo and behold, there they are. They have a square root when you multiply them together, the square root. Okay, so again, square root of 10 does not have a nice square root, square root of 18 does not have a nice square root, and we get them to kind of work together to come up with a square root and simplify. John's going to walk us through.
I think I got it.
Think, it looks fine.
Yeah.
Start with what you think.
So
right
I
around.
Multiplied them to get square root of 180.
Okay.
And then I did 36, the square root of 36. times the square root of 5, and then 6 times the square root of 5.
I guess then you're going to get 6 root 5. Charlie got 6 root 5. It's a bit of a challenge, so well done. Great, so, like, I saw some of you, and this would have worked. I think it would have taken a little bit longer, but trying to write square root of 10 as the square root of 2 times the square root of 5, which is true, and then the square root of 18 is like, okay, 9 and 2, 9, right? 9 is a square root, so it's 3, and you have all these other square roots to multiply together, and it certainly is going to, as long as you don't make any mistakes, like math mistakes, that's going to work out as well. So the square root of 2 times the square root of 5 times the square root of 9 times the square root of 2, right? Square root of 9 is 3. Okay, well there's a 3, pulled that out in front, got the square root of 2 times the square root of 2 times the square root of 5, right? What's the square root of 2 times the square root of 2 going to be?
Square root of 4.
And the square root of 4?
Square root of 2.
What's the square root of 2?
Just 2.
2.
2, yeah, the square root of 4 is 2. So then here we get square. So when I multiply the square root of 2 times the square root of 2, I just get?
2.
2. Does that make sense? Yeah, because I'm going to get the square root of a number that is 2 times 2, which is 4. Square root. So I could go that long way around and say, hey, look at that. The square root of a number times the square root of the same number, which is going to be that number. Square root of 2 times square root of 2 is 2. So 3 times 2 is 6. And there's our leftover square root of 5. 6 root 5. Let's start at the beginning and look at it in yet another way, using kind of this observation. Let's just prime factor both of these, meaning we break it down as far as we can to where prime numbers are multiplied together to give us those numbers. So you get the square root of 2 times 5. I'll just write that inside the square root there. Okay. Prime factorization of 18, we can do 2 times 9, but 9 is 3 times 3. Now, they've been factored as far as possible until all the factors are prime numbers. If I were to multiply these together under one square root, let me try and move this up a bit, separate it. If I were to multiply these together, I'd get the square root of 2 times, well, here's another 2, times 3 times 3 times 5. See what we did there? Now I'm going to get a 2 times 2. What's 2 times 2?
4.
4, and it's going to come out. It's going to be square root of 4. Square root of 4 is 2. Right? So where I see a pair of 2's,
it's going to be 1.
It's going to be the square root of two 2's multiplied together, which is 2. And the square root of a 3 times a 3 is going to be
3.
And the square root of 5 is, well, sadly only square root of 5. It's not going to simplify at all. But I can see, like, oh, these two 2's are going to multiply together. Get it multiplied together, get 4, the square root of that is going to be 2, because why? 2 times 2 is 4. It's just kind of this, like, just going to trip around the block, but I could have just gone right to this is 2, and this is going to be, the square root of that is going to be 3. 2 times 3 is 6. 5. Okay? Is any one of these the one way you're supposed to do it? No, of course it's not. It is any one of these. You want to do it that way, do it that way. Right? I'd recommend, if you don't care, you don't have a certain style already, I recommend this one right here. Because I can start back here, I can factor these numbers, which are small, into their prime factors, rather than going all the way up to 180 and then trying to figure out, of 180, what's the biggest factor that has a square root? I recommend to think that way. But that's correct, so I wouldn't say don't do that. That works great. If you're good at finding factors that are square roots, do that. But I think this is a little bit simpler. You can factor it to its prime factors, as small numbers. See, you can even see it before you even multiply them together. That 2 is going to multiply by that 2. Right? It's going to give you a 4 squared, and 4 is 2, so that gives me a 2. These 3's already, you can break them apart. Square root of 9 is 3, and the square root of 5 is the only thing that's going to be left over. One more thing, and then I think we'll just take some time to do some homework. It's the negative square root of 25. Now, is that the same as the square root of negative 25?
No.
What do you think? multiplying things together, this thing times this thing, and the same square root, yeah?
Well, if it is in the square root, then it'd be negative 25 times, or just negative 5 times negative 5 or something.
So we have to find a number that multiplies by itself to give us negative 25. Does anybody see a problem with that?
There's no number.
There's no, we've talked about this briefly before. There's no way we're going to multiply a number by itself and get negative 25. 5 times 5, positive 25. Negative 5 times negative 5, because it has to be a number by its exact copy, is also positive 25. This is not going to happen. But this is just a negative. Square root of 25 is 5. Negative 5. No, they're not the same thing. Let me do that. How about 5 times the square root of 6? That the square root? 30? 5 times the square root of 6? What would I have to multiply together to get the square root of 30? Josie?
The square root of 5 and the square root of 6.
Root of 5 times the square root of 6 is the square root of 30. This 5 times the square root of 6 is not the square root of 30. As Josie pointed out, if we were to multiply two numbers together inside square roots, they each have to be in their own square root. So I could make this the square root of 6 times the square root of, what's 5 the square root of?
25.
Okay, so if I wanted to multiply 5 times the square root of 6, I'd have to turn 5 into a square root form, if you want to call it that. And 25 times 6, okay, that's the square root of, where are we at? It's 150. Okay, if I wanted to for some reason, but that would be kind of silly because this is simplified. This is the simplified form.
Yeah.
So, all things we want to remember, especially when we come up with something like 5 times the square root of 3x. We're not trying to multiply 5 by 3, get the square root of 15x. And if you ever make that mistake, I understand. There's a lot of stuff. You remember some of it, you forget other parts of it. But if you do make that mistake, I'm going to come up with some example of like, well, remember this? Like, that couldn't be true because you don't multiply a non-square root number by something inside the square root. Right. You're getting confused and look at this example and rather than just say, oh no, don't do that without any explanation. I will always explain it. It's going to take longer than you want it to, but it's better that way. So, we have a few minutes.